So here to discuss the findings of this research is our counselling psychologist, Vikki Baird. Welcome back, Vikki, to Take It From Us. It's been a few months.
Thank you, Sheldon. Yeah, it's nice to be back a short break myself.
Except probably not a short break just sitting on the beach in Fiji.
Unfortunately not.
Or sitting on the beach in Pihar. I noticed you on Facebook enjoying Pihar.
That was my short break.
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested in these short breaks because nowhere does the research actually talk about how long a short break is, unless I've missed it somewhere.
Oh, I believe there was, yeah. I think it was between 1 and 3 days away.
Right. So. Well, let's get into this research. Firstly, how did you come to access this research by Choice Hotels Asia Pacific?
I was approached as part of, I was approached by a media company who were distributing the research out on behalf of Choice Hotels. So they were looking for an advocate or someone who could speak from a psychological perspective. I didn't end up being part of that work opportunity for various reasons. However, as you and I were talking about it, we both felt that, you know, the research would be interesting to share. It had some interesting points.
Yeah, well, it definitely has some great insights into the level of stress in New Zealand society. So what does this research say about the stress levels of New Zealanders?
So overall, in general terms, it reported, before we get into that, just to give a context. So this was an online survey that was carried out in March this year. So it surveyed 1,002 Kiwis over 18 years old who were living in households earning a minimum amount of $50,000 per year. So this is online research. It was a basic survey format. And what it came up with in general was that 65% of those people surveyed reported some level of stress. So 53% of them were what you would call moderately stressed and 12% were very stressed. So that's over half the population who had significant levels of stress.
Does that finding surprise you? I mean, that's actually 67% that are moderately or fairly intensively stressed.
65%. Yeah, it doesn't actually surprise me because what I do notice, so when I'm doing adult mindfulness groups in the community, we take statistics as well, and about 80% of the people that come along to those groups come because of stress, you know, stress levels for some reason. So the statistics themselves didn't really surprise me.
I mean, I got that revelation when I went to it wasn't your particular mindfulness works course, but it was a mindfulness works in Mount Eden. I think you do them out west. And when the facilitator asked why people were there, there was a very large majority of the people attending who were young mothers who said they were very, very stressed. They were unable to focus on what their children were doing, what their children were saying to them, and they recognised that they just weren't present for their children particularly. I guess that was a major reflection of stress.
Yeah, that's it, you know, and that touches on the point that was the other finding in this report, you know, that the significant causes of stress for people, the top three are work, finances and family issues. Those are the top three things.
Right. Among men and women, who are the most stressed in our society?
Take a guess, guys, out there. What do you think?
Living with us men makes it very stressful.
No comment on that. 71% of women, I'll let the statistics do the talking, 71% of women are stressed and 60% of men, according to this research. So obviously, quite a significant higher amount of women, although the statistics are still very high for both sexes.
So any revelations about why women present as appearing to be more stressed? I mean, perhaps they are just more emotionally intelligent and are prepared to be honest about it, open about it, admit to it, whereas us guys hide it away.
A fair comment. Yeah, I do think that's probably one of the factors in there. Like, although the research report doesn't go into details around that, it just looks at the plain statistics. From my perspective as a counselling psychologist, working with adults, I think there's a lot to do with the, with how men and women measure or connect to their stress. Women, it's often easier for women to admit they're stressed. Society looks on that more fairly, whereas men, you know, there's that kind of harden up, get on with it mentality. So there is that. I also think that, as you said, Sheldon, women tend to be a bit more in touch with their emotions, so they can see when they're stressed, whereas men might not be able to see it so well. The other factor that I think comes into this, and what I often see, particularly in individual work with adults, is that often women in a relationship, in a marriage, women tend to be the holders of the emotion, you know, and that's because, you know, that's because often men have grown up, you know, we've grown up in a society where we haven't got much intelligence around emotional intelligence. There's not much out there to teach people, and particularly for men. So often the feelings or the emotions that the men are dismissing or pushing away in themselves, the women in the relationship can pick that up and tend to be the ones that then hold that anxiety and hold that stress. So I think that's got a lot to do with it as well.
I think you've already given us a bit of an insight into what Kiwis agree is the best way to relieve their stress.
What came up was that 44% of the people surveyed agreed that short breaks were one of the main keys to relieve their stress. I mean, the choices they got within that were, so the choices were short break, sleep, exercise, sex, a bath, food, alcohol and shopping. So those were the choices they got. So this is 44% out of those choices that chose a short break.
And do you think those options were realistic stress-busting options? I guess they are, aren't they? A hot bath, maybe sex?
Yeah, I believe so. I think the one thing that's missing from there, which I might have put in, would be something around psychological tools, counselling or talking to people, you know, or even mindfulness, you know. So
like talking to a friend.
Yeah. So that's things that were missing out of that list that you could say may have made a significant change. However, you know, it's interesting what you, in light of what you just talked about, Sheldon, you know, that short break is up there, you know, because that is, you know, particularly in this culture, in the Kiwi culture, there is so much, you know, culture around getting away, you know, going to the batch, getting away from things.
That is a tradition, and that's one of the things that I had in mind when I read this research, because the research actually says that most Kiwis only take two short breaks a year. They'd like to take more. I think they'd all like all different age groups, the millennials, the baby boomers, the others, they'd all like to take at least four short breaks. But what is it that constrains them from taking those breaks?
So according to this report, the main constraints are work and finances. Those are the top two. So work was up there as number one, but finances were a very close second.
Well, they're very closely tied together, aren't they?
If
you're dependent on money from your work, then the things are just inextricably linked, aren't they?
Yeah, that's it. So that's the thing that we don't really know from the report. Right? We don't know how those two work together. We don't know what elements of work hold people back. You know, is it a reluctance to leave work, at home, or is it more tied in with that financial thing? We're not quite sure, but we can we can make some educated guesses.
But the research actually suggests that even when people take short breaks, what happens, Vikki?
40% of Kiwis in this survey stay connected to work in some way.
So even when they're on holiday, when they're taking a short break.
Yep.
And they've taken that break probably because they've recognised their stress, which probably mostly comes from work.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. I mean, obviously, there'll be a small amount of people within that 40% who might need to stay connected in some for some reason, but that doesn't count for all. I'm sure that there's a lot of people there that are just staying connected because they've feel obliged to, or they accept it as part of the culture, or whatever. The other interesting statistic was that within that, they also asked people, you know, if they felt any guilt or if they just accepted that staying connected to work was okay. And it was very high. It was 76% felt no guilt about staying connected to work and actually accepted it as part of everyday life. So that's quite high.
Well, I mean, if you've taken your family away, you've taken your children away on the short break, your wife, and yet you're on the cell phone or you're on the iPad checking the emails, and there's no guilt associated with that. You know, how do you feel about that finding? Do you find that surprising?
I guess in one way I'm not so surprised when I actually observe, you know, the culture of our society. But in another way it is surprising. I mean, 76% of people accepting that this is just the way things are. I think that's shocking, you know, and I think that highlights something that's, you know, fundamentally wrong in our society. I think there's a huge expectation now, particularly now with, like, you know, emails, smartphones, social media, you know, there's this expectation that people are always available.
That they're available 24/7.
Yeah.
But, you know, they're wanting to take a short break. They're recognising that a short break is the way to bust their stress.
Mm.
And yet they're undermining the benefit of that short break, aren't they, by staying connected with work. Now, and we're talking to counselling psychologist Vikki Baird. It's great to have Vikki back in the studio. And she was involved in some research on Kiwi stress levels, which was commissioned by a major hotel chain, Choice Hotels Asia Pacific.
So they were asked to rate themselves in terms of one, either no stress at all, the next one up was not very stressed, and the next one was moderately stressed, and the highest was very stressed. So there was 7% said no stress at all, which is great, because I don't encounter many people that say they have no stress at all, but they're obviously out there. 28% were not very stressed, so that's not too significant. I mean, that probably just means that it was the average stresses of daily life. But definitely the figures that are most interesting are the fact that over half the people surveyed were moderately stressed, and 12% were very stressed. So that's half the people who were, you know, getting on that, you know, moderate to very stressed level.
So let's reinforce, what are the major issues that are stressing Kiwis at the moment?
Yeah, so the first one was work. So 62% of people rated work as being the main cause of stress, or a major cause of stress. Next after that was finances or money. So that was 57%. So both of those were quite high. So work 62, finances, money 57%. The next one on the list was family issues, and that came in at 36%. So about a third.
Right. So there are other things that are less stressful, cause less stress in Kiwis' lives. What are some of the things that were detailed in the research?
So people, so within that context, so there was work, finances, money and family issues. Those were the top three. The other options that were in this survey were illness. So 22% of people rated illness as being one of the causes of stress, which makes sense as well. Interestingly enough, household chores was up there, quite significant, 20%. Children, 19%. Kind of interesting. I would have thought that maybe children would have been more, just going from the observations and what you said earlier, Sheldon, that, you know, many, many adults come along to the mindfulness groups via mindfulness works because of, you know, how to parent, how to, you know, look after their children. Interestingly enough, 15% also noted society expectations as being a cause of stress. And what was interesting about that was because they surveyed, so they broke the population up into, so the millennials, so that kind of leaving school, going into the early 20s, so that's the kind of 30s, 40s, and then the baby boomers, you know, so going 50s.
So the things that stressed those three different parts of society were different, weren't they?
They were different. However, work and finances and money were top for across the board.
Yeah.
Things like, for instance, social expectations was quite high in the millennials, so that was like 24%, whereas in the Generation X or baby boomers, that did not come in.
Right.
Kind of makes sense, you know. Obviously, children were a bit higher in the Generation X sample, so children were 27% of the stress.
Yeah. I mean, work is a very general, it's a generic term.
Mm.
As a psychologist, do you have any insights in what are some of the things specifically within that big category of work that are stressing people out?
That's a good question, Sheldon, because, I mean, that's something that obviously the research doesn't go into, and it will be interesting to do a bit more research around that. You know, what is it? Is it, you know, for some people it may be lack of work, you know, not getting enough work, you know. Particularly, you know, in New Zealand there's a lot of people that are self-employed as well, you know, so that plays a big factor. If you're self-employed, you know, how do your short break habits change? What are the barriers?
Well, I think you're much more restricted in being able to take a short break, because if you're a sole operator, then you have to be there to service the business and service the client.
Which could play into that factor, you know, that statistic we looked at around people taking work with them, you know. So there's all these kind of different factors. From my observations working with adults, I know one of the main causes of stress at work seems to be the culture that we're in now in society. Organisations are just increasingly, you know, there's less and less money and people are expected to be doing more and more with their time and their energy.
Well, the health sector and the mental health sector specifically, I think, is known for that now, isn't it? There's no extra money to fund services. All those of us that are working in mental health are required to do more for the same money.
And that's it. And it's not just mental health, you know, it's across the board. You know, that's what adults come into time and time again. They come into my mindfulness groups, and those are the kind of things that are coming up, you know. It's just more and more expectations placed on people. So I think that has got a significant factor to do with us.
I mean, lack of work or being on the benefit, that's not a category that has been included in this research.
Yeah, well, we don't know how people have rated this. You know, it's been an online research. So for someone who's struggling to get work, they might have rated themselves as work being a major stress. That's what we don't know. We don't know how people have interpreted these.
And then I guess there's all the things like relationships at work, relationships with our managers, bullying, just the pressure of achieving goals, I guess, achieving targets. You know, if we're a salesperson and we've done well one particular month, then there's an expectation that we're going to have to do well every month and better that target.
Yeah.
These are all the pressures that cause work to be the big stress issue in our society.
Yeah, I mean, it's real interesting. There's so many complex issues around work. And again, I mean, it makes sense in a way because work, you know, work is a main part of our life. You know, it's a mainstay for most people in their life. So it makes sense that there's going to be stressors there.
Yeah.
It's going to be significant. I mean, it's interesting that work is, you know, 62% people. So 62% people rate that being the main cause of stress, whereas family issues are half of that, or just over half of that at 36%, and you would expect that they would probably be up there too, because that's the other main part of our lives.
You know, we've got this statistic which shows that women are more stressed than men. I mean, I suspect that women are more stressed because they take so much more of the responsibility of family, of collecting the children from daycare or having to organise the grandparents to fill the gap before mum gets home or dad gets home, you know. I mean, really, unfortunately, in New Zealand, the owner the responsibilities fall on woman for the family, I think.
Yeah, and that's true, Sheldon, and that reflects in the results that women definitely rated family issues as being a higher cause of stress. Work was still up there. It was the main cause of stress for women, but family issues were up there for women as well. For instance, women in comparison to men, so 42% of women rated family issues as being a main cause of stress, whereas 30% of men did.
So
it makes sense that
they are
family.
Insulated a little bit from the family issues often, aren't they? I mean, I'm being very general here, but perhaps men come home later from work. Women have to take that responsibility. They have to look after the domestic side of things. It's an unfortunate separation of responsibilities, I suppose. I'd like to think there was more equality, you know, and more men cooking and more men taking on some of the family responsibilities.
However, on the other hand, you know, much more men are stressed about work and finances. So, you know, they're up there, like 69% of men are stressed about work versus 56% of women. So,
so men are possibly still in that role of being the provider and feeling the stress of perhaps the sole breadwinner, the sole salary earner, that sort of thing.
Yeah, so that makes a natural, you know, I think that just naturally reflects what's happening still in society. However, that's changing, I think. That balance is changing.
Well, let's hope so. Yeah. Men are taking more responsibility in the kitchen. Well, we're talking to Vikki, our resident psychologist, about this research, why Kiwis are stressed, what is stressing them out, and how much is work tying them down. And the research commissioned by Choice Hotels Asia Pacific suggests that we may have work a little bit out of proportion, out of kilter, Vikki.
Work seems to be the main relationship in people's lives, actually.
And is that healthy, do you think? I mean, it does sound as though there's a little bit of an imbalance here.
It certainly does. I'd like to see that balance being a bit lowered. You know, it'd be nice to think that people have a more of a work-life balance,
But essentially, I mean, it's my belief that this is a reflection of the fact that costs are going up, rents are going up, mortgages are a huge sort of albatross around people's necks these days. If you want to get into the new Auckland market particularly, or any housing market in New Zealand, you've got to borrow $500,000 or $600,000 unless you're in a very privileged position or have got rich parents. So that's got to be serviced every week, doesn't it? Or if you're paying anywhere between $600 and $800 in rent, and I've got a couple living across the courtyard from me that are paying $700, parents with one child. I mean, that's a huge drain, and it's a constant amount of money that is just going out every week.
Yeah, that's true, Sheldon. You know, I think the climate, particularly in Auckland, you know, it's such a huge responsibility for people. So it makes sense that work and finances are up there as the main concern.